Hello friends, I had just given an interview in WDTS, Walker Digital Table Systems. This interview was happened at 12 years of experience when I was a technical lead in one of the companies. There were very good questions asked, so I will share all the questions along with the answers. Let's start with the first question. What is reentrant lock? Reentrant lock is a mutually exclusive lock with the same behavior as the intrinsic implicit lock accessed via synchronization. Reentrant lock, as the name suggests, possesses reentrant characteristics. That means a thread that currently owns the lock can acquire it more than once without any problem. Reentrant lock forces one thread to enter critical section and use all other threads to wait for it to complete. Basically, Java 5 introduces the concept of a lock. Lock and read-write lock are the two interfaces in Java 5, and their implementations are reentrant lock and reentrant read-write lock. It was the first question, and it's a very basic question about locking. Next question is, how to handle service fallback in microservices? So when you are at 12 years of experience, you are supposed to work in microservices nowadays. Alright, so you must be familiar with all the patterns of microservices. So, to handling service fallback, we can use circuit breaker pattern implementation like Netflix Hystrix for handling fallback in microservices. Actually, in microservices based architecture, there are many applications running in different processes on different machines, and any of these services may be down at some point of time. So to avoid sending all requests to this microservice which is down, circuit breaker pattern can be used, and its implementation is Netflix Hystrix that can be used. Let's move to the next question. What are REST core endpoints? Because we have to implement web applications, so we have to call REST core endpoints. So it is a very basic question asked in the interview. So let's suppose, for example, we have the URL https://api.github.com/user/delweb/repos/short=post. In above URL, the first part https://api.github.com is the root endpoint. /users/delweb/repos, this part is the path which determines the resource we are requesting for. The last part of an endpoint is query parameter. Query parameters give us the option of modifying the request with key value pairs. We always begin with a question mark. Each parameter pair is then separated with an ampersand symbol like this. Query 1 equal to value 1, ampersand query 2 equal to value 2, and so on. So you should be having a knowledge of all the REST code endpoints questions. Let's move to the next question. Explain the life cycle of Spring V. In the interview of Java, at an experience of more than 8 years, you are supposed to work with the Spring. Then this question becomes a very important one, right? So its answer starts from the container. Whenever the Spring Bean container starts, means our application context starts, it will instantiate the bean and then it will populate all the properties. It calls set bean name and set bean factories afterwards. Then calls set application context, which returns application context aware interface instance. Then bean post processors calls post process before initialization method. Here the mean gets initialized, and then after property set method gets called, and after that the custom init method of the mean gets called. Then mean post processor post process after initialization gets called. Here the mean gets ready to use. Now the container is shut down. For that, it calls the custom destroy method of disposable bean, and then bean's destroy method gets called, and the bean goes out of the container. So it is the entire life cycle of Spring Bean. Let's move to the next question. Explain the steps of sending a request from browser and handling it at server side. If you are working in the development of web application, you should be aware of each and every step of how the request is handled at the server side. The first step is, first request from browser client side will be received by dispatcher servlet. That is a front end controller in any web application. Dispatcher servlet will take the help of handler mapping and get to know the controller class name associated with the given request. So now request transfers to the controller, and then controller will process the request by executing appropriate methods and returns model and view object back to the dispatcher servlet. Now dispatcher servlet sends the view name to the view resolver to get the actual view page name. Finally, dispatcher servlet will pass the model object to the view page to display the result. You should be well known about all these steps. Let's move to the next question. Name all the HTTP verbs. In this, you have to tell about the names of all the verbs along with their functioning. HTTP verbs are get, put, post, delete, head, fetch, we all know. So, get verb is used to request a resource from the server. Put verb is used to update the resource on the server side. Post is used to create and resource on the server. Delete request is used to delete the resource from the server. Head basically is similar to get, but it will not fetch the resource. It will just fetch the metadata information about the resource. That is, what kind of data we are supposed to get. Suppose we have an endpoint REST users. If we are using get, it will fetch a list of users. But if we are using head with slash users, it will fetch the metadata that what we are getting, how much users we are getting. Are we getting an array or a list or other object? This kind of information we can get from head. Fetch. Fetch is a sub part of put. Put basically used to update the entire resource, but fetch is used to update a resource to some partial extent. Basically, it is used to partially update the resource. Let's move to the next question. What is a dispatcher servlet? Dispatcher servlet handles all HTTP requests and responses. As I told in the previous question, it is a front controller in Spring MVC based applications. Dispatcher servlet uses its own web application context, which is a child of application context created by context loader listener. Okay, so the next question is, when we override hashCode method, then how to retrieve the actual default hashCode value for that object? This is a very good question on the hashCode. So the answer is, just use system.identity hashCode, passing the object as a parameter. The value returned by a default implementation of hashCode is called identity hashCode. Identity hashCode is usually the integer representation of the memory address of the object. Hashcode of an object is a 32-bit signed in that allows an object to be managed by hash-based data structure. So guys, thanks for watching. Thanks a lot.